Well, good morning, church. It's great to be with you on this Christ the King Sunday, the Sunday before Advent. We are zooming towards Christmas, if you can believe that. It seems like at warp speed. But welcome this morning. I want to make one announcement, is that we have not really had any plans between the two churches to have an Advent study, but I would like to offer that on Thursday morning through the month of December, starting not this coming Thursday, but a week from Thursday, to have a small group that we talk about Christmas and Advent and all those kind of things. So let you put that on your calendar. It'll be at 10 o'clock on Thursdays during Advent. And Rick has some more announcements. Rick, thanks.
Morning, church. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. I can feel his mighty presence and his grace. I can feel the brush of angel wings. I see glory in his face. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. I have two announcements. One is the Polk stockings that we will be filling again this year. There's going to be something in the bulletin next week as far as what items to put in here. They don't want any food or candy, but there will be a list, and they need to be back by December 10th. So those are in the back of the church. Also, the Thursday ecumenical service will be this week on Tuesday at 7 o'clock at the St. John's Episcopal Church. So if you'd like to attend that, you may. So those are the two announcements I have. Any other announcements anybody has? Oh, you have another one?
You said it was the Thursday ecumenical
service? It's Tuesday.
It's Tuesday, but it's the Thanksgiving ecumenical service. Just to let you know.
Was your objective to point that out to me in front of all my friends here?
just.
Thank you so much for that. Are there any other announcements? Yes. Are there any other announcements? If not, let's begin our service with the hymn, which we'll see up on the screen.
Thank you.
Would you please join me in the opening prayer and praise? I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. Blessing and honor and glory might be unto your Lamb. Worthy is Christ, who has ransomed us by his blood from every tribe and tongue and nation, and made his people a kingdom and priests to our God. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Amen. You may be seated.
If the kids want to come forward.
All right. Good morning. Just two of you today, huh? Okay. All right, so let's see. I am going to need a volunteer to be blindfolded. Nobody? Nobody? Okay. You volunteer, sister. All right. Okay, let me see. The passage in the Bible that we're going to talk about today is from Isaiah 9:2. You say that? Isaiah 9:2. Okay, zip lips. All right, fine. All right, so I will read it to you, and I want you to listen very carefully. All right, the people walking in darkness have seen a great light on those living in the land of deep darkness. A light has dawned. You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest, as warriors rejoice when dividing the plunder. Let's see. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders. He will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. All right. So, now when I was reading, did you hear the Christmas story? No, you didn't hear it? Well, let's see. Let's talk about the Christmas story. Do you remember what happens in the Christmas story? You don't remember? I think you do. I think it starts with Mary and Joseph, and then who comes to see Mary? Do we remember? An angel, very good. And what does the angel tell her? That she's going to have a baby, very good. And what will that baby's name be? Jesus, very good. Now, Mary and Joseph, they get married, and then do you remember where they go? No, a town called Bethlehem. And do you remember what happens in Bethlehem? They look for a place to stay, but what happens? They had to stay in the barn. Very good. With all the animals. Now, where was Jesus was born in the barn, and he was laid in a manger. Very good. Very good. There is a song about it. All right. Well, the story of Christmas is the beginning of something new. Jesus being born changes everything. Now, the Isaiah reading that we just read talks about people who can't see the good things in life or don't have hope, finding hope and love. It is about people who have difficult lives finding relief from things that are hard. Now, some of those things could be like being sick or getting bullied or just being sad about something. Now, we get used to these things, so when they are taken away, it is surprising. Now, all of this is why Jesus came to earth, why he was born. So what do you think it feels like to have a burden like that or something that is, it hurts you, taken completely off you? What do you think that feels like? You think it feels sad, or do you think it feels good to not have to feel that way anymore? Do you think it feels good? Yeah, very good. Very good. All right, why don't we go? I have to be blindfolded. Well, we skipped that part. We skipped that part because you guys didn't want to. Why don't we go ahead and pray? Father, I thank you for this day, and I thank you for sending your son down as just a little baby. We thank you for providing hope through him, among many other ways, Father. Just help us to see that hope throughout this week, and help us to look to you. In your name I pray. Amen.
Take some time this morning and greet each other with the love of Christ. Well, good morning once again, church. Let's take some time this morning and still our hearts before we go to the Word of God. Let's pray. Lord God, we thank you for this time that we could look at your Scripture. We thank you for such a Sunday as Christ the King Sunday. And as we think about you as King over our life, we pray that our hearts would be humbled and that we would be seeking you to reign over our lives and our experience here on this blessed place that you put us. And we just pray this in your name. Amen. Scripture passage this morning is from the Gospel of Luke. It's chapter 23, verses 33 through 43. If you're so able this morning, stand as we read the gospel message. When they came to the place that is called the Skull, they crucified Jesus there with the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Then Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they cast lots to divide his clothing. And the people stood by watching, but the leaders scoffed at him, saying, "He saved others. Let him save himself, if he is the Messiah of God, his chosen one." And the soldiers also mocked him, coming up and offering him sour wine and saying, "If you are a king of the Jews, save yourself." There was also an inscription over him, "This is the King of the Jews." One of the criminals who were hanged there kept deriding him and saying, "Are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the others rebuked him, saying, "Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed have been condemned justly, for we are getting what we deserve for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." He replied, "Truly, I tell you today, you will be with me in paradise." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. You know, the idea of king is not a new idea. It is something that we may have grown up reading in our children's books or our fairy tales. And I have preached on kings and kingdoms before. But I want to go back today and look at what it means to be king. We are a little unfamiliar with what that term means in our society, for we do not have a king that reigns over us where we live. We have a president and a soon-to-be new president and a vice president and a cabinet of people in our country. In our schools, we have principals, but we don't call him or her king or queen. Our boss may want to be king or queen over our lives, but we don't let them. The man of the house may have wanted to be king, and maybe some are called that, but usually husband or partner is best. The word king in our society is thought to be arrogant. If you remember the movie Titanic with Leonardo DiCaprio standing up on the boat saying, "I am king of the world." You know, if I would say I was king of the church, I'm sure you'd be talking about me at your dinner table today after church. We have kings in our society, but they are the burger kind, or the king of pop, if you remember Michael Jackson or Elvis is king. But real kings, we don't necessarily have them. Sure, we read about them and we have them in our cartoons and in our neighborhood of make-believes. But we don't have kings in our culture. So what is a biblical king? That's what we need to kind of look at today. Maybe you have heard about people like King David or King Solomon. But who were they? And what kind of kings were in the Bible? Well, the office of king, the office of king was common in the Middle East since the beginning of time. he was usually over a centralized area, such as a city. His authority was thought to be hereditary and handed down, and it was thought that it was divinely appointed, meaning the god of that particular land appointed the king. In the early times, the father or the clan, the father of the clan was ruled by the patriarch, the father. During the Exodus, the rule was exercised by the likes of Moses, and then we see after that the rule of Joshua. But it was essentially called a theocracy, meaning that it was a government that was led by Almighty God. When Israel first settled in Palestine, the tribes were largely ruled by village fathers, who would call a certain man to lead the militia against an enemy. These were known as judges. Though there were not always men, there was one named Deborah that was a mighty warrior. There was Gideon and there was Jephthah. The book of Judges, though, ends on a note of social chaos. And this is attributed to the lack of a king. The following period was one of improvement under the religio-judicial, a leader being both religious and judge, like the lead of Eli and Samuel. Samuel was the kingmaker, if you remember scripture. It was thought that God was still head, but because of the threat of such of the likes of the Philistines or an enemy, they needed a king. So the king could be thought of as a protector. Saul's success as a warrior was his main qualification for the role of the first king of Israel. After Saul, David became the king. You know that guy, the little kid with the slingshot that took down Goliath. He established a dynasty that lasted over 400 years until the breakup of the state in 587. His lineage, his family, that's where the great king comes from. The main responsibility of the king was the maintaining of the righteousness. Under David's lead, there was a covenant made with him that a great king would come out of his lineage. But again, the main responsibility of the king was the maintaining of righteousness, the maintaining of living right. And that happened by obeying something called the Torah, which was their scripture. The king had the duty not only to act as a judge, but to preserve justice and proclaim the law. But we see in David that he was not a perfect king, if you remember, because of his lustful heart, he had a man killed. Yet, he is known as having known as being a man after God's own heart. And if you read through scripture, you'll see that there were many wicked kings, and the prophets had to step in and remind the kings of their waywardness. After the kingdom's fall and the Israelites are taken into captivity, we see many priests take the role of king and claim to be that of something called a Messiah, the chosen one, or savior. So as you can see, the Israelites are expecting or wanting a king, a great king, a Messiah, the great king that is promised from the reign of Israel that will reign over them. But they are expecting a mighty warrior type king on a mighty horse. And what do we see? We see Jesus on a donkey. And here in our passage today, brought up on charges, being hung on a cross for being king of the Jews, which is a charge of treason against the emperor. In fact, if you read a little bit before this or in another gospel, you'll see that Pilate, the governor, says, "Do you claim to be the king of the Jews?" And Jesus tells Pilate that his concept of kingdom is different than his. If his kingdom were really a threat to the empire, Jesus's kingdom, surely Jesus would have organized a revolt. But his kingdom is not from here. The whole idea of kingdom, in some ways, is not non-political. And this is confusing for Pilate. And he asks, so then you are a king. He must have been thinking that Jesus was a king of some sort. So Jesus tells him that he was born to bear witness to the kingdom. He came to bear witness to God. He shows that in our scripture passage today to the thief on the cross, to show us who God is and how he will save us. Jesus came to tell us about salvation. You know, the more that I read about the Gospels and the more that I learn from studying the life of Jesus, especially the Gospel of John, I am convinced that the main purpose of Jesus was to tell us about God. Bring us salvation and to tell us about God. To show us who he was. To point us to the kingdom. We are so hung up on words sometimes, aren't we? Language can be a big barrier to our understanding. Kingdom is one of those words. The kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven. It is for the future, yet it is for us as well now. You know, I wish I had all day to expound on it. I really don't have to be anywhere till 4:30. Do you want to stay with me today? I didn't think I'd have any takers at all. Oh, okay, I have one. Yeah, let's think of it this way. Where you see God, that's where you see the kingdom. Yet because of who we are in a state of sin, we only see glimpses of this king, only see glimpses of this kingdom. And you know what? Jesus came to give us the picture of the kingdom, to show us the right way to live. And what did we do? We killed him. So sometimes I think as humans, we really don't want to see the kingdom. We are too busy trying to satisfy our own needs. Some of us are trying to see the kingdom, yet other people get in the way sometimes. You know, I think it's sometimes like the going to a movie theater and the lady with the big hat sits in front of you, can't see it anymore. Yet I want to tell you something this morning. Yes, we can see glimpses of the kingdom with Jesus reigning over it. But there will come a day where we will see the kingdom in its glory. We'll see the whole picture. Jesus will come again, and there will be no more sorrow and no more pain. We will experience God's glory in a way that we have never experienced it before. We will be restored. Yet, we will need to be ready, and we will need to understand. You know, we rejected Christ and Christ the King once. Let's not reject him again. For you see, the idea of king is not necessarily a new idea. Yet we need to be seeking our king, not worrying about his return, but being ready. Knowing what it means, King Jesus, so that we can be ready for the kingdom that he brings and restores. Amen. Lord God, as we get ready for this Advent season where we welcome you into our life as King, let us first start thinking about what a King is, what a King can be in our life, a King that points us to a right way of living. And so let us start looking at how you lived, and so that we can live by example to others, and so that our life would be more fulfilling, more rich, more holy. And we just pray this in your name. Amen. Let's join together with the next hymn. may be seated. As we go to the Lord in prayer today, let me remind you of the people that we are praying for throughout our week that's found on the opposite side of your scripture passage this morning. Is there anything that we need to add to that, joys or concerns? Lisa. So we have a joy this morning with Zamira, who is winning the cancer fight. And you guys got to know each other during your cancer fight. Amen. Good. She's doing well. Along with that, I can announce that my sister is having surgery on Tuesday. We can be praying for her as she continues to fight this battle of cancer. But they're hoping that this will be able to solve her problem with cancer, as they feel that it's pretty much self-contained. Any other things to be praying for today? We want to continue to pray for the Whitman family, who is dealing with the loss of Jason's dad, continue to pray for our colleagues at the Christ Church. We want to pray for David Jantz as he's recovering from a bout in the hospital. Any other joys or concerns this morning? Lisa? Yeah, we are glad to have Leah here today too. Amen. Well, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord God, we thank you for this time of worship. And we come before you knowing that you are indeed King of our life. And we ask that you would reign over it. Help us to seek your ways so that we live like you want us to live, a holy and righteous life. Help us to know your ways. And Lord, as we think about that this morning, we want to confess that we are a people that walk away from you. We are a people that look towards other things. We are broken. We are misled. We are sinful. And we ask for forgiveness this morning as we think about those things in our life that take us away from who you are. But we are also so very grateful and thankful. And as we think about this week and this holiday that's right before us, we are a people who have a thankful heart for a loving God. And we thank you for your Son and for the sacrifice and what that means for us. We thank you for a place to live that you've given us, a place of freedom, a place that provides, a place that we are not hungry. And we lift those folks up this morning that are struggling with those kind of things. And Lord, we want to continue to pray for those who are fighting cancer, for dealing with loss, for fighting all kinds of sickness. We pray for those who will have a lonely holiday, and we lift them up to you. We pray that they would realize that we are never alone with your presence among us. And Lord, we just want to lift up those in our society too that are in need of financial need, physical need, spiritual need, emotional need. We lift those folks up to you. And we probably could all name different folks, and we just lift those names up to you today as we pray. And Lord, as we pray this morning, we are thankful for the way that you showed us how to live, showed us how to live right. And one of the things that you showed us is how to pray. And we pray that prayer this morning by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let's prepare our hearts this morning for the morning offering. Lord God, I thank you for this time that we can have together, and we pray that we would be able to use this gift that we receive today to be about your kingdom, to show folks who you are, so that they can be blessed to live right lives. And we just pray this in your most blessed name. Amen.
Thank you.
Let me remind you that we have a Thanksgiving service at the St. John's Episcopal at 7 o'clock, and we're going to be decorating the church at 5. Is that right, Jeremy? Tuesday. Both of those things are on Tuesday. So let's prepare our hearts as we leave this place today, preparing our hearts for the King as we go into this Advent season, knowing that the Father loves us, the Son has provided, and the Spirit continues to do a work within us and through us.